Hi friends, welcome back to the channel Ani's Lectures. In this session, we'll discuss the topic logical clock in distributed system. So what is logical clock and what are the two different mechanisms to define a logical clock in distributed system? First one is Lamport's logical clock, or also known as Lamport's logical scalar clock. Next one, what is vector clock? So first of all, what are logical clocks in distributed system? Let us see that. A logical clock is a mechanism for capturing chronological and causal relationships in a distributed system. Distributed systems have no physically synchronous global clock, so a logical clock allows global ordering on events from different processes in such systems. Instead of using the physical clocks, we use logical clocks that keep track of times based on the event that occur at the processes. The basic technique behind the logical clock is happen before relationship. Let us see what is the meaning of this happen before relationship in logical clocks in distributed systems. So let us assume that we have two events, A and B. We say that event A has been executed before the event B. That is, A happened before B if either of the following conditions are true. The first condition is the event A and event B are executed in the same process, also known as internal events. So here this diagram. Here I have a single processor. Here I have two different events, A and B. So the event A has been executed before the event B. So here A happened before B within the single process, that is process P1. Or A is an event corresponding to sending of a message M at one process, and B is the event corresponding to the receipt of the message M at another process. So here, A and B are two different events or executed in two different computers. So here, A is an event of sending a message M to this processor P2, and B is the event of receiving the message M from this process P1. So here, we have three different events. The events are internal events and sending a message event and receiving of the message event. The event can be categorized into three different types. So in that cases, the event A happened before B. So based on this happened before relationship, we have derived three different properties. The number of properties derived from happened before relationship. The first one, transitive relation. Second one, causally ordered relation. And third one, concurrent event. So what is the meaning of a transitive relation? So if I have three different events, event A, event B, and event C, if event A happened before event B and event B happened before event C, then it is true that event A happened before event C. That is known as a transitive relation. Next one, causally ordered relation. If this event A happened before event B, this means that A is occurring before the event B, and if there is any changes in this event A, it will surely reflected on this event B. So that is known as causally ordered relation. Third one, concurrent event. This means that not every process occurs one by one. Some processes are made to happen simultaneously. In that case, A is concurrent process to this event B. So A and B are two events. They are parallel to each other. So that is known as a concurrent event. This is the space type diagram describes how these number of processes or globally distributed, and here In each processes, we are having a number of internal events, and here from this process P1, we are having number of events. So here event from process P1, 1, that is E11, and second one, the second event from process P1, and this is the second event, and event from process 1, this is the third event, and event 1-4. Next one, from this process P2, we have event from process P2, which is the first event, and event from process P2, second event, and event from process P2, third event, and event from process P2, fourth event. And E11 and E21 are internal events, whereas E12 is a message sending event, and E23 is a message receiving event. And again, E22 is a message sending event, and E13 is a message receiving event. So here, from process P1, we are sending a message to this process P2, and from process P2, we are sending a message, that is event, event 22, to this process P1, that is event 13. Next one, the implementation rules of logical clocks. So instead of making use of the physical clock, how these number of events are globally ordered based on this logical clock time. So here we have two different rules according to this Lamport's logical clock. It is also known as a scalar clock. So here the rule one, for two successive internal events, the clock time is the clock time value plus 1. Whereas for rule 2, for message M sent from process PJ at timestamp TM, the value of this clock time CI at process I equal to the maximum of this clock time value at this current process and the timestamp value plus 1. So this is one of the diagram. We will see this how this logical clock time we can set for this number of events very clearly in a diagram. So here, based on this Lamport logical scalar clock, how this timestamp value can be assigned for this number of events in two different processes, we will see. So here this is the event 1-1, that is the first event from process P1. So initially the clock time was 0, and for all these internal events or message sending event, we have to increment the clock value plus 1, and if it is message receiving event, then we have to compare this current clock value with this timestamp value. So here for this event 1-1, it is one of the internal events. So here the clock time value is 0 plus 1 equal to 1. Next one, for this event 1-2 from this process P1, it is a message sending event. So we have to increment the existing clock time value plus 1. So existing value is 1. So here 1 plus 1 equal to 2. And this is also one of the internal events. So we have to increment the clock value as 1. So here 2 plus 1 equal to 3. And third one, it is one of the message receiving event. So we have to compare this timestamp value along with these messages received from this event 2-3. So before that, let us see what is the value of this event 2-1 from process P2. So here this initial value of this process P2 is set as 0. And here this is the first event from process P2, and it is one of the internal events. So here the clock time value equal to 0 plus 1 equal to 1. And the next one, this is one of the message receiving event. So according to this rule 2, we are receiving this timestamp value from this event 1-2 to this event 2-2. So we have to compare this timestamp value of 2 and the 1, which is the clock time value of this existing event from this process P2. So here when we are comparing these values of 2 and 1, the maximum value is 2. So take this maximum value plus add 1. So here 2 plus 1 equal to 3. So that is the timestamp value for this event 2-2 from this process P2. Next one, this is one of the message sending event. So just increment the value as 1. So here 3 plus 1 equal to 4. Next one, when I send a message from this process P2, that is event 2-3, I'm sending this timestamp value along with this message. So here this event E14, when receives this message, we have this timestamp value from this process P2. So here process P1 will compare these two values of 4 and the existing value 3. So here take the maximum of these two values. So here the maximum of 3 and 4 is 4. So add 1 with this, the maximum value, that is 4 plus 1 equal to 5. So that is the timestamp value for this event E14 from process P1. So that is the mechanism of how this timestamp value can be assigned for this number of events and how this number of events are globally ordered in this distributed system. So here, one of the limitations of this scalar clock is, we'll see the limitation of this scalar clock. So let us see the limitations of Lamport's scalar logical clock. Looking at Lamport's timestamps, we cannot detect a causal relationship in Lamport's logical clock, and we are not able to conclude which events are causally related. So Lamport's logical clock is also known as a partial ordering of events. Let us see this example. So here, if the event A happened before event B, then it is true that the timestamp value of A is less than timestamp value of B. But in some situations, if it is one of these concurrent event where the timestamp value of A is less than the timestamp value of B, then we cannot conclude that either this event A happened before this event B or not. So it is not true for this concurrent event according to this Lamport's logical clock. To overcome this particular problem, the solution to this problem is to make use of a vector clock. So here we can see an example of the limitations of Lamport's logical clock. So here in this space-time diagram, we have three different processes. And we are having a number of internal events, message sending event and message receiving event. So different timestamp value has been set for number of events. Here we can see that the event 1-1 has this timestamp value as 1. And from process P3, we have this event 3-2, which has the timestamp value 2. So here, even though the clock time value of E11, that is 1, which is less than the clock time value of event 3-2, that is the value 2. So here, the value 1 is less than the value 2. But we cannot say whether this event E11 happened before this event 3-2 or not. In other words, we cannot establish the causal relationship between these two events in a concurrent process in Lamport's logical clock. So here, if these two events are concurrent event, and even though this timestamp value is lesser than this timestamp value event 3-2, that is 1 is less than 2, but still we are not able to establish the causal relationship between these two events. So here, instead of making use of this scalar clock value, we can make use of a vector clock value to overcome this problem. If this timestamp value is less than other event timestamp value, then definitely we can say that there is a causal relationship between the events. So that is the concept behind this vector clock implementation. So here this rule for a vector clock is, we have two different rules. So here a vector value has been initialized. So here we are having a vector of values. So here the number of indexes represents a number of processes in this global system. So here, according to this rule one, the clock time of I equal to Ci of I plus one for two successive internal events at process Pi. And rule two, that is at process Pi, the Ci of j equal to, take the maximum of Ci of j and timestamp value of j for all processes Pj, where timestamp value from this message is the vector timestamp borne by process M received by process Pi from some other processes. Let us see an example of vector clock implementation. So here, this is one of the example for vector clock. So here in this space-time diagram, we have three different processes and we are having number of internal events. So here this clock time is one of this vector value. So here each index represents the number of process. So here in this event E11, we are having a vector value. The first index 1 represents the process P1. The second index 0 represents process P2. And third index 0 represents process P3. How this timestamp value can be set for this number of events in this number of process according to this vector clock time? We'll see an example. So here, according to this vector clock time, how this timestamp value can be assigned for this number of events, we'll see one by one. So here in this space-time diagram, we have three different processes and we are having a vector value. So here we have three different index value. Each index represents three different process. So here the first index represents process P1 and second index represents process P2 and third index represents process P3. So for all these internal events and message sending event, we have to increment the corresponding index value plus one according to this rule one. And for this, according to this rule two, we have to compare this timestamp value and the existing clock time value of this particular processor. So let us see how this timestamp value can be defined for each event. So here this event 11 belongs to this process P1. So here it is one of the internal events and the initial clock time value has been set as 0, 0, 0. And here, this index, the first index represents process P1. So here this index value has to be incremented as 1. So here 1, 0, 0, that is the timestamp value for this event 11. And second one, it's a message sending event. So here we have to increment the corresponding clock time value of this particular event, that is the index, the first index belongs to this process P1. So we have to increment the value as 1 plus 1 equal to 2 and the remaining value as same. So 0, 0. And next one, third event, event 13. So here again, increment the clock time value of this process P1, that is 2 is incremented as 3. And write the remaining value as it is, 0, 0. Next one, event 14, it is one of the message receiving event. So we have to take the maximum of these two values, that is the current value, that is 3, 0, 0 from this process P1. And the message which is received from this event, event 24, so here these two values has to be compared and we have to take the maximum of that particular element. So before that, let us find out what is the timestamp value for this event 2 1. So here in process P2 we are having a vector value. So here this second index represents process P2. So here event 2 1 is one of the internal events. So here we have to write the timestamp value as 0, comma the second index value, that is 0, has to be incremented as 1. So 1, comma remaining value, I have to write the same 0. Next one, event 2 2. So here it is one of the message receiving event from this process P1. So that is the event 1 2 is sending a message to this event 2 2. So here along this message, the timestamp value 2 0 0 has been sent to this processor P2. So here when we are going to assign the timestamp value for this event 2 2, we have to compare this message timestamp value along with this existing value, that is the previous value, that is 0 1 0. So here we have to compare these first indexes 0 and 2, take the maximum of these two values. So here the maximum of these two values is 2. Next one, the second index represents process P2, so we have to increment the value as 1 + 1 = 2. Next one, the third index, we have to compare these two values 0 0, so that is the maximum value is 0. So that is the timestamp value for this event E22 from process P2. And next one is also one of the message receiving event. So we have to find out, so what is the value of this particular event, event 3 2. And before that, here event 3 1, we have to assign the timestamp value. So here initially it was 0 0 0. Now the last index represents the process P3, that is incremented as 1. So remaining, we have to write the same value. So here 0 0 0 1. So next one, this is also one of the message sending event. So here the value is 0 0 0. The 1 will be incremented as, so here 0 0 0. The third index 1 is incremented as 2. And here this is again one of the internal events. So here the value is 0 0 0. The third index is incremented as 2 + 1 = 3. So here it is 3. And here in this case, event 2 3 receives a message from event 3 2. So that is along the message, the timestamp value, that is 0 0 0 2, has been sent to this particular event, event 2 3. So when we assign the timestamp value for this event 2 3, we have to compare this timestamp value and the previous timestamp value, that is 2 2 0. So here, first take these first two indexes, that is 2 0, take the maximum of these two elements, that is 2. Next one, comma, the second index represents process P2. So here this element, this value has to be incremented as 2 + 1 = 3. And the third element, that is, we have to compare these two elements, 0 2, take the maximum of these two values, so that is 2. So 2 3 2 is the timestamp value for this event 2 3. And next one, event 2 4 is sending a message to this process E 1 4, and here it is one of the message sending event. So we have to increment the corresponding index value alone. So here the remaining value we have to write as the same. So here 2 comma, the 3, that is the second index value, has to be incremented as 3 + 1 = 4, comma the remaining value, I have to write the same, that is 2 4 2 is the timestamp value for this event E 2 4. And here for this event 1 4 from this process P1, we have to check this timestamp value, that is 2 4 2, along with this existing timestamp value 3 0 0 from this process P1. So by comparing these two elements, so here the first index represents process P1. So that is incremented as 3 plus 1 equal to 4, comma. The remaining value we have to compare. So here the second index 0 and 4, take the maximum of these two values. So that is 4. And next one is 0 comma 2. Here take this maximum of these two elements. That is 2. So that is the timestamp value for this particular event, event 1-4 from process P1. So here, this is the method of vector clock implementation. So here, how this different timestamp value has been assigned for this number of events for different processes. And let us see this, how this limitation of Lamport's logical clock we have overcome from this vector clock implementation. We'll see. So we have described very briefly how this timestamp value has been set for this number of process according to this vector clock implementation rules. So now we will see the advantages of this vector clock implementation. So here, by making use of this vector clock timestamp values, we can compare these number of events. That is, we can compare this timestamp value of different events, whether it is equal, not equal, less than or equal, less than or concurrent. So here, if timestamp value of this event A, if it is equal to timestamp value of this event B, if for all processes Pi, then we can see that the timestamp value of this event each element, that is index value, is equal to the timestamp value of this event B. And we can see that here it is not equal by comparing each index values. And here we can see it is less than or equal, or less than, and if it is concurrent. So let us see an example. So here, the properties of this a vector clock defines a total ordering of events. That means with vector clocks, we can very clearly say that for any two events, event A and event B in process Pi and process Pj, whether they are causal related or not. So from this example, we can say very clearly that this event 3-1 and event 1-4. So here this event 3-1 has the timestamp value as 0, 0, 1, and event 1-4 has the timestamp value as 4, 4, 2. So by comparing these two index values, so here the first index 0 is compared with the first index 4. So here 0 is less than 4, and next index 0 is compared with the second index 4. So here 0 is less than again 4, and the third index 1 is compared with the third index, that is event 1-4, that is the value 2. So here 1 is less than the timestamp value of 2. So here we can say that the timestamp value of event 3-1, that is 0-0-1, is less than the timestamp value of event 1-4, that is 4-4-2. So here, even though these two events, that is event 3-1 and event 1-4, are concurrent event, and by considering this timestamp value, we can say very clearly that the event 3-1 has been executed before the event 1-4. So here we can establish a causal relationship between these two events, event 3-1 and event 1-4, by considering its timestamp value. Again, we have one more example, that is event 1, 2. Its timestamp value is 2, 0, 0, and we have on event 2, 4. Its timestamp value is 2, 4, 2. So here we can compare these two index elements. So here the first value, that is 2, is compared with the first value 2, that is 2 is less than 2. So here it is not true. And 0, second index 0 is less than 4. So this condition is true. And the third index 0 is compared with the third index of this event 2, 4, that is 2. So here 0 is less than 2, the condition is true. If at least one of the condition is true, then we can say that the timestamp value of this event 1, 2 is less than the timestamp value of event 2, 4. So here, even though these two events are concurrent event, that is event 1, 2 and event 2, 4, so these two events are concurrent events, still we can establish a causal relationship between these two events by considering these two timestamp values. So that is the implementation of a vector clock mechanism in a distributed system. So in according to this logical clock timing, so here, whereas it was not true for this scalar clock, by considering a single scalar value, even though this time is lesser than this another event, we are not able to establish a causal relationship in Lamport's scalar logical clock, whereas in a vector clock, it is possible to assume that whether there is any causal relationship between these two events when the events are in parallel execution, and by taking its timestamp value, we can very clearly see that whether these two events have any causal relationships or not. Whereas the third example, that is we have one more example, that is event 1, 1 and event 3, 3. So here event 1, 1 has the timestamp value 1, 0, 0, and event 3, 3 has the timestamp value as 0, 0, 3. So here we are going to compare these two vector values. So here this clock time 1, that is the first index 1, is not less than or equal to the first index 0. And second one, 0 is not less than or equal to the second index 0. And the third index 0 is not less than or equal to the third index 0. And in the reverse order also, for this event 3, 3 has this timestamp value 0, 0, 3. This value is compared with the timestamp value of event 1, 1, that is 1, 0, 0. The 0 is not less than or equal to 1. And the second index 0 is not less than or the second index 0, and the third index 3 is not less than this third index 3. So in that case, all the conditions are false. So here we can very clearly say that the event 1, 1 is parallel to this event 3, 3. And we can see one more example, event 1, 3, that is event 1, 3 has the timestamp value 3, 0, 0, and event 2, 4 has the timestamp value, that is 2, 2, 4, 2. By comparing these two vector values, so here first index 3 is not less than 2, and second index 0 is not less than 4, and third index 0 is not less than 2. And again, in the reverse order also we can check it out. So here 2, 4, 2, that is the event 2, 4, and 3, 0, 0 from this event 1, 3. So here 2 is not less than 3, and 4 is not less than 0 and 2 is not less than 0. So here, by comparing these vector clock time values for this concurrent process, the condition is timestamp value of A is parallel to this timestamp value of B, that is the event A is parallel to this event B if the timestamp value of A is not less than timestamp value of B and timestamp value of B is not less than timestamp value of A. So here, in both the conditions, so here for event 1-1 is parallel to this event 1-3 when we are comparing the timestamp value of event 1-1 with this timestamp value of event 3-3. So here 1 is not less than 0 and 0 is not less than 0, 0 is not less than 3. Again in the reverse order, 0 is not less than 1 and 0 is not less than 0 and 3 is not less than 0. So in that case, we can say that event 1-1 is parallel to this event 3-3 and we cannot establish a causal relationship between these two events. And for this event 1-3 and event 2-4, we have the timestamp value received as 3, 0, 0 for event 1-3 and 2, 4, 2 for event 2-4. So here, the value 3 is not less than 2 and 0 is not less than 4. And 0 is not less than 2. Again, in this reverse order, the value 2 is not less than 3 and 4 is not less than 0 and 2 is not less than 0. So in both the cases, the condition is, that is, the values are not less than these other values. So here we can say that even 1-3 is parallel to this even 2-4. Whereas for this event 3-1 and event 1-4, we can establish a causal relationship even though it is a concurrent event. And here for this event 1-2 and event 2-4, we can very well define that there is a causal relationship between these two events. Because by comparing the number of individual index elements, if one of the condition is true, then we can say that the timestamp value is lesser than the timestamp value of other events. So in that case, we can very well define that if there is two events A and B in process PI and process PJ, whether they are causally related or not. That is known as a total ordering of events in terms of vector blocks. So overall, we have discussed in this particular session about what is a logical clock mechanism. So that is, instead of making use of the physical clock, we can assign the timestamp value for individual events from different processes which are globally distributed, and how this global ordering of the number of events has been implemented. And the logical clock implementation has two different mechanisms. One is Lamport scalar clock and another one is vector clock. So here Lamport's logical clock, also known as partial ordering of events, and vector clock is also known as a total ordering of events. So I hope you understand the concept very clearly. Thank you so much.